Good evening, everyone. My name is Claire DeRoche. I'm the social justice coordinator for this congregation. On behalf of the Social Justice Committee and the Green Sanctuary Committee of this congregation, it's my pleasure to welcome you here this evening. And what wonderful energy there is in the room. This is terrific. That's why I like gatherings like this. They make me feel re-energized. So welcome. Our congregation is always happy to host events like this. We belong to a denomination that is committed to a world community of peace and justice for all. And it's being with folks like you, it's having events like this, it's being engaged with the issues of our day that make a difference for all of us, that we fulfill our mission. So welcome tonight. I know we're all going to learn a lot and we're going to be better prepared to defeat the TPP. Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. And we are so lucky to be able to use Shelter Rock as a location for this event. So we really thank you for being here, right? So my name is Lisa Tyson. I'm director of the Long Island Progressive Coalition. And we've done an event here on this issue in the past. And when you hear about the TPP, it just makes you want to do something. So the one thing we're going to say about being here tonight is you need to do something and act. We're going to get into that and tell you what it is. But when you try to explain what the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, to someone who doesn't know about it, it's a very hard thing to do. It's confusing, it's horrifying, and there's a lot of things that it affects. So I am so appreciative that people are here because we're going to learn from our experts on this issue, we're going to learn more, and we're going to learn to what do we do to actually stop this thing? It's huge and it's hard to stop. Everyone here needs to participate to do that. So I'm gonna first thank the organizations that have actually co-sponsored this event because we have a great turnout tonight. We've been working together on this event for quite some time now. And if it wasn't for organizations and individuals like you guys, we would not be able to stop this horrible plan. So the UUCSR Social Justice Committee, Food and Water Watch, Sierra Club Atlantic Chapter, LongIslandMoveOn.org, New York State Alliance for Retired Teachers, Long Island Federation of Labor, Long Island Progressive Coalition, Communication Workers of America, Working Families Party, Grassroots Environmental Education, Reach Out America, Green Party of Nassau County, Coalition of Black Trade Unionists, Global Justice for Animals and the Environment, Long Island Jobs with Justice, 1199 SEIU, United Healthcare Workers East, Trade Justice, New York Metro, Slow Food, North Shore, I Eat Green, Sierra Club, Long Island Group. Who are we missing? Anyone else here?
Long Island Bernie Sanders.
Thank you. Anyone else? Exactly. Perfect. Anyone else? Yes. Huh?
Peace Smith.
Excellent. So thank you everyone for co-sponsoring and being here. Really appreciate it. So what are we gonna do? We could sit here and just talk about it forever, but it's about action, right? So what do we need you to do? The whole evening is gonna be focused around what are you gonna do, what the problems are, and how we're gonna stop it. So I'm just gonna kind of summarize targets and actions, and then we're going to go deeper into that. So on Long Island, our key targets are Congressman Steve Israel and Congresswoman Kathleen Rice. So many of us supported Kathleen Rice in her race for Congress, and she said she was opposed to this plan of the TPP, and then she supports it now. So our tactic is to remind her of her previous support and to try to convince her to change her position. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah.
Anyone here angry at her over it?
Yeah. Woo-hoo!
Yeah. So we have to make sure we're constantly contacting her. Now, Steve Israel, he's retiring. And who knows when you retire what you're going to do? You actually might do something more progressive than you would have done before, because he doesn't have to dial for dollars every day, right? So we actually think we have a good chance of moving him. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Awesome. So those are our two targets. There are other targets, and we could talk about them a little later. More people are going to talk about it. But those are who we think our best targets are on Long Island. So what are you going to do those targets? Writing letters. Now, a handwritten letter to a congressperson means a lot. Form letters are great, petitions are awesome, but handwritten letters, talking about a personal situation of why you think this is wrong. How would the TPP affect you? That is key. Phone calls, especially from constituents, that's what they want to hear from, is the people who live in their district who will vote yay or nay at the booth for them. That's who you need to call. Organizations also need to be calling and sending letters saying their support, and it doesn't have to just be in the district they're organized in. Island-wide organizations of any type can call any congressperson and make an impact. So petitions, lobby visits. Get in those offices, get outside those offices with signs, make sure they're hearing from you guys and they're seeing you face to face. Local resolutions we're looking into, maybe at like a Long Beach, you know, are there any local communities that can actually make some resolutions? We want to consider that. Letters to the editor, we need to be getting in there. So there are other things we're going to be talking about tonight, but it's really about action. So after tonight, make sure, you know, you pick a few of these things to do. If you have an organization, create a plan for yourself and your members, and you want to make sure that you're doing stuff right away on this. So we are so lucky that Food and Water Watch has really been a leader on this campaign, especially for the groups on Long Island. Eric Weltman has really always been just constantly hounding us to do things, right? Just reminding us, because there's so many issues we all work on, right? And it's so hard to focus on something like this because it seems like it's so hard to win. But he has really been making sure we're organized, we're doing something, and he really has us focusing. So Eric is going to come up here and talk to you about what you should do and the problems.
So good evening. Thank you very much, Lisa. I should say that Long Island Progressive Coalition is a phenomenal organization that you all should be supporting and getting involved with, and has been a real staunch ally here on Long Island. So I want to thank Lisa for participating tonight. So Food and Water Watch is a nonprofit environmental and consumer organization. Our mission is to promote safe, affordable, and accessible food and water, and to protect these vital resources from corporate control and abuse. We're based in Washington, D.C., but I work out of an office that we have in Brooklyn, and we held monthly meetings, actually, here at Shelter Rock. And we helped lead the successful fight against fracking here in New York. Woo-hoo! All right. And now we're involved in a campaign to label GMO foods. And frankly, Food and Water Watch is concerned, very concerned, that the TPP threatens just about everything that we care about and that we're working on. That is that the policies and programs that we fought so hard for to defend our health, safety, and environment can be gutted as so-called, you know, barriers to trade. Now, I brought a bunch of materials with me tonight. My hope is that I'd leave without any of them, including a flyer here that we recently designed. It's to enable people to call their member of Congress. It features a toll-free number that will automatically connect you to your own member of Congress, as well as enable us to track the number of calls that we're generating. So it's a very valuable tool. Now, I want folks to raise your hand if you're committed to calling your member of Congress tomorrow. I want to see a lot of hands raised. Okay. Raise your hand if you're committed to calling your member of Congress on a regular basis to show the commitment that you have to this issue, how much it matters to you, because that's one of the things that members of Congress and other elected officials base their position on, is not just how many people care about an issue, but how much they care about it. So we got a lot of hands raised for people who are going to call on a regular basis. How many people here tonight, raise your hand, if you're committed to recruiting at least 5 of your friends or family to call as well? Please raise your hand. All right, so I want to go, I don't want to take any of these flyers with me when I go home tonight. Thank you. So a little bit more about our concerns about food safety and labeling. Now, I'm going to ask you, raise your hand again if you think that we should be able to label our foods if they're genetically engineered or GMO. All right, well, I'm glad to see a lot of hands. We're concerned, Food and Water Watch is concerned, that the TPP could jeopardize food labeling requirements. We're concerned that the TPP will increase the flood of imported fish and other food into the United States, swamping the ability of inspectors to stop tainted or unsafe food. I know that's a particular concern on Long Island. We're starting to reach out to the fishing community. We're working with the North American Marine Alliance. It's a group of a progressive group of fishermen and fisherfolk. So that's something to keep in mind. If you folks out there have connections in the fishing community, we definitely want to engage them, particularly here on Long Island, on this issue. We're concerned that the TPP could threaten food safety standards. So for example, currently the U.S. imports more than 500 million pounds of fish and other seafood every year from Vietnam and from Malaysia. These are countries where farmers raise shrimp, crabs, catfish, and lobster in overcrowded ponds. To combat disease, the fish in these countries are fed a dangerous cocktail of drugs. Only 2% of this imported seafood is inspected by the Food and Drug Administration. The TPP would open up U.S. markets even further to imports of this potentially dangerous seafood. A second concern is that the TPP could result in the overturning or blocking of common sense food labels, as I said, so-called barriers to trade. These include labels that inform consumers of the ingredients contained in their food and where the products are from. In fact, the United States has already weakened its dolphin-safe tuna labeling rules because of a long-standing dispute with the WTO, the World Trade Organization. And a couple of months ago, the World Trade Organization ruled that knowing where our food comes from is a barrier to trade. That is the so-called country of origin labels, which Food and Water Watch and other allies fought tremendously to win. That these so-called cool country of origin labels have hampered Mexican and Canadian exports of meat to the United States, a ruling that could come with a bill of $1 billion. And in response, Congress eliminated country of origin labeling. We are also very worried that the TPP could threaten efforts to label GMO foods, which, as I mentioned, is a major initiative for Food and Water Watch. We're working hard as we speak to pass a GMO labeling bill here in New York. We've got a lot of organizers, a lot of activists, a lot of allies, on the ground here in New York. And, as I said, that initiative, even were it to pass, could be undermined as a barrier to trade, which is just one example of the ways in which the TPP could undermine local sovereignty. And I do just want to acknowledge that we have a county legislator here, Laura Kern. We're very glad to have you here today. Thank you for joining us. And, as we acknowledge it, I do want to note that, the threats to local sovereignty are a major concern for us. Such a concern that the Attorney General, Eric Schneiderman, New York's Attorney General Eric Schneiderman, wrote a very powerful piece in Politico magazine addressing the TPP's threats to sovereignty. The New York City Council passed a resolution in opposition to Fast Track and the TPP, again raising concerns about local sovereignty. And State Senator Jesse Hamilton from Brooklyn is circulating a sign-on letter to his peers. We have 22 signatories at this point, none of whom, I should mention, are from Long Island, but 22 state senators signed on to this letter thus far, again addressing how the TPP could undermine state and local sovereignty. So, to sum up, much of our concerns are centered around the authority that corporations have to challenge government policies that infringe on their profits. This is known as the investor-state dispute resolution, or the ISDS process, and Food and Water Watch actually has a fact sheet over on the table there, please take them all, that addresses this issue. And finally, I'll just note that another concern is that buy local programs could also be deemed barriers to trade, along with buy local programs as well. And efforts to encourage schools and other public institutions to serve local produce could be undermined as a consequence. So again, please make the calls on a regular basis, take the flyers, encourage at least 5 friends or more to make calls as well, take the petitions, take the fact sheets, take the flyers, get involved with organizations like LIPC and Food and Water Watch and Sierra Club, because we're all working together on a steady basis to ensure that we defeat this bad trade deal. Thank you.
For our next, thank you so much. That was really informative. And the GMO stuff, it's like, come on, give me a break, guys. Use your brains. We know what's right and wrong, and they're not doing it. So thank you for doing that campaign. So our next speaker is Ryan Stanton, the political director of the Long Island Federation of Labor. And he's going to come up here and talk about the impact on labor. I don't know about you guys, but NAFTA wasn't so great, right? To think we're going to go right back down that same path is incredible, and labor is really up here fighting. Federation of Labor is doing a great job, Ryan is, so he's going to share with you what they're doing.
Lisa, thank you for the introduction, and everybody, thank you for giving up your evening. I see a lot of brothers and sisters from labor here, so thank you for making it out. And for those of you not familiar with the Long Island Federation of Labor or our national organization, the American Federation of Labor Congress of Industrial Organizations, we're the workers' voice in the workplace. We give a voice to the voiceless. We advocate for those that are not in a position to advocate for themselves. We represent 56 different unions and 12.5 million workers across this country, many of whom are either not our brother and sister any longer because they lost their jobs as a direct result or indirect result of poor trade policies, of agreements like the North American Free Trade Agreement and CAFTA, and pretty much every trade agreement that's occurred under both Republican and Democratic administrations. This trade agreement is just a repeat of those failures. We've lost millions of jobs. It's projected that NAFTA alone displaced 682,900 jobs between 1994 and 2014. Permanent normal trade relations with China. Direct job losses chalked up to about 3.2 million jobs. Now, this was supposed to be the gold standard of trade policies, and apparently Representative Rice and Representative Meeks took Trade Representative Michael Froman at his word, but this is actually a step backwards from the May 10th language in a prior trade agreement that was negotiated under the Bush administration. The language in this trade agreement is aspirational. It's we may or we endeavor to encourage, and when I say that, what do I mean? We may or we endeavor to encourage countries like Brunei, countries like Vietnam, to actually enforce labor protections. They're not doing it now. They have little to no incentive to do it as we pull down barriers to trade over the next 5, 6, 7 years. And it takes 5, 6, 7 years before any sanctions, any penalties can be imposed upon those countries, and they're even then limited. And over those 6 or 7 years, the bulk of the benefits have already been incurred by those countries. So again, what incentive do they have to bring down or to enforce actual labor standards? They don't. So I started with, what are these trade agreements? What are the mistakes that have been made? And what should the trade conversation be about? The trade conversation, and I think everybody in this room would agree, should be about increasing wages, increasing jobs, and promoting economic development. The argument and the proponents utilize language to say that this is a growth in the economy. What they fail to give you is the other half of the equation. They talk about the increase in exports, but every single trade agreement we've signed, NAFTA forward, has produced a trade deficit. They're leaving out that other half. They're leaving out all of the products, everything that floods our markets that ultimately increases our trade deficits. So as a labor movement, we would argue that, again, this should be about promoting higher wages. This should be about shared prosperity and inclusive growth across trading partners. And if you take a look at the partners that we've chosen in this trade agreement and many before it, I mean, you have countries like Brunei that their penal code is based off of Sharia law. In Vietnam, workers don't have the right to organize, don't have the right to associate. In several other countries, if you have a group of 5 or 10 people gathering, they have to have permission from the police. We're choosing to partner with these countries, and then we're saying that this is going to be the gold standard of trade agreements, that this is going to be the highest labor protections that have ever been afforded. So whether you're a Republican, a Democrat, or any other party, you're delusional if you genuinely believe that those labor standards are going to be enforced by these partners. They have no incentive. They've done nothing to create any sort of infrastructure to offer any indication that that's going to take place moving forward. They've never done it before. Why are they going to do it now? That's all I have.
Thank you, Ryan. It's really horrifying. You know, it's so angering. I don't think that's a word, but it just pisses me off when I hear both parties say they support workers, and then they vote for this kind of thing, right? And they vote for a lot of bad things that actually hurt workers, and that's why it's so important for us to have a strong labor force and the Federation of Labor, Roger, Ryan. It's so important to make sure that we're understanding really the details of it, and we really appreciate you laying it out for us, so thank you. So our next speaker is Stan Bergman with the Alliance for Retired Americans. Stan's gonna be really talking about how does this affect the retiree population. We have a huge retiree population in this country, right? And this will certainly impact them directly. Stan?
Hi, I'm speaking for the Alliance for Retired Americans, but we've got partners, Doctors Without Borders, AARP, Oxfam, all agree with us that this is a bad policy. There are a number of things that are going to go wrong, and it starts at the core, because the pharmaceutical interests pushing for lengthy patent exclusivity for a longer period of time. I believe that right now it's 5 years, and they want to go anywhere from 7 to 12 years. That means that there will not be generic versions of their drugs. They are not encouraged to lower their prices because there's no competition. There's also another part of this agreement that is absolutely horrendous. It gives the drug companies the ability to sue for profits that they've lost. In other words, if in a case like Medicaid or the Veterans Administration, where they normally would seek lower prices, less than market prices. If they did that, we would be sued by the companies, the drug companies, and it would cost us for compensating them for their so-called loss of profits. Beyond that, under the Affordable Care Act and the Vet Administration, with the donut hole closed, that's going to also cause us to automatically be drawn into those kind of suits from the drug companies, because these prices that we're using right now are below what they consider the fair market price. There's also an effect on the 340B program, which makes discounted prices of drugs available to such places as community health centers, public hospitals, rural critical access hospitals, Ryan White clinics, and others that provide medicines to low-income patients who could also be in trouble as they receive drug discounts that could be challenged as discriminatory by the drug makers. Instead, the TPP rules are drawn by lobbyists as bonuses for their clients in the drug industry. There are marketing exclusivity rights which create pharmaceutical monopolies even when a product is off patent, and there is no compelling evidence that these rules will spur medical innovation or create jobs. Americans pay the highest prescription drug prices in the industrialized world, and last year drug prices went up by 13%. That's more than 8 times the rate of inflation in a single year. We think Congress should be working on ways to reduce drug costs rather than making the problem worse. This is not the time to support an agreement that could further increase drug costs to consumers and the government while lining the pockets of the pharmaceutical industry and lead to a threat to more lives. The TPP final rules will lead to lead to preventable suffering and death. In other words, we can prevent it, but they won't let us because we won't be able to get their drugs. We all need some kind of medication at one time or another, but the people that really depend on medication more are the elderly, and that's why we feel that it's going to hurt elderly people on Long Island. This is the reason why the Alliance for Retired American stands in opposition to the TPP. The well-being of America's senior citizens depends on it.
Thank you, Stan. Who would have guessed the pharmaceutical industry would get in on this? I mean, come on. This is like their golden egg, right? This is just horrifying. But of course, they're going to get every single thing in this plan that they want. We are going to have questions very soon, so hold off on that. But we will definitely be giving questions out there. So our next speaker is Mark Kinukan from the Sierra Club. Which, you know, the Sierra Club does an amazing job really working on environmental issues, energy policy, and he's going to be talking about the threats to fracking and the environment in general. Mark?
She asked, did she pronounce it right? It's Kinukan. I want to thank the organizers and in particular Stephanie Lowe, who invited me to speak at this event. And I'm particularly grateful because while I've been against the TPP, I always had a little bit of uneasiness about that because I didn't really know what it said. And so I took this opportunity to actually read the environment chapter and some of the other relevant parts of the of the proposed TPP. And now I can say, as George Fox said, this I know experimentally. Today we would say experientially. Mm-hmm. It really is all that bad. And so what I want to do is just briefly go through a little bit about what's in the environmental chapter and talk about the various mechanisms for dispute resolution that the TPP provides, particularly with respect to the environment. The thing that, you know, has angered me most in my, you know, as people have been against the TPP is hearing about how the investor state dispute resolution, or ISDS, can wreck sovereignty and instance, and for instance, in which it took exactly 2 weeks for Congress to overrule the meat labeling after the WTO imposed a penalty shows the power of that. And I wondered, well, do environmental groups and other non-governmental organizations have comparable clubs in order to, or whatever you want to call it, enforcement possibilities? And the answer is a resounding no, and I'll talk a little bit specific about that. So the environment chapter of the TPP has about 20 different sections, and some of them are topical. There's covering things like the ozone layer and fishing and trade in species and that sort of thing. And then there is actually one section in it that's about climate change. Now, you read a lot that the TPP doesn't use the term climate change, and that's true, it doesn't. But it does have one section called Transitioning to a Low Emissions and Resilient Economy, which basically you could take as being about climate change. After reading the chapter, the word that came most to mind is milquetoast. As I think it was Ryan mentioned in the labor chapter or one of the other chapters, there's lots of maze and strive and voluntary, and not much in the way of shall. And whenever there is a shall, there's a hedge. The only place I could find there wasn't a hedge was on reporting. There was an unhedged shall in relating to reporting about what's going on with the environment. So to give you a sense of the tenor of it, it starts out with a section on objectives, and there's three objectives, and the first one is to promote mutually supportive trade and environmental policies. I would say mutually having, but I'm not sure mutually supporting, but that's the term they use. And then also it has an objective relating to the importance of cooperation in tackling environmental issues in the context of the agreement. And then it has this third objective. The parties further recognize that it is inappropriate to establish or use the environmental laws or other measures in a manner which would constitute a disguised restriction on trade or investment between the parties. Mm-hmm. That's the first time I've ever seen a scold be part of the objectives of something that you're trying to achieve. But that's basically what it is. So I was really heartened when I saw the section on, that there was a section on transition to a low emissions and resilient economy. This is how long it is, the entire section.
Oh my God.
I'll read it. The parties acknowledge that transition to a low emissions economy requires collective action. The parties recognize that each party's actions to transition to a low emissions economy should reflect domestic circumstances and capabilities, weasel, 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 and consistent with Article 2012 cooperative frameworks, parties shall cooperate to address matters of joint and common or common interest. Areas of cooperation may include, but are not limited to, energy efficiency, development of cost-effective low emissions technologies. I won't read all of the laundry list of aspects of ways to be concerned about global warming. And then it ends with, further, the party shall, as appropriate, engage in cooperative and capacity-building activities relating to transitioning to a low-emissions economy. We're staring down the maw of global warming, and this is what the TPP says on the subject. Okay, so I want to contrast then, to finish up, how it deals with environmental issues in the investor-state dispute settlement section and how it deals with enforcement of the environmental section. The investor-state dispute settlement section does have, and one of its articles says, nothing in this chapter shall be construed to prevent a party from adopting, maintaining, or enforcing any measure otherwise consistent with this chapter that it considers appropriate to ensure the investment activity in its territory is undertaken in a manner sensitive to environmental health or other regulatory objectives. That means it seems to say that, you know, you can use the environmental concerns as a way to combat negative things that may come from this agreement. But there's this little clause in there that says, any measure otherwise consistent with this chapter, the chapter on dispute, investor-state dispute settlement. So I was curious about that, so I Googled it and found an article in The Guardian that quoted an environmental lawyer who represents governments in these kinds of things. He says, the entire provision is negated by five words in the middle, unless otherwise consistent with this chapter. So at the end of the day, this provision, which really held out a lot of promise of being very protective, is actually much ado about nothing. And then the thing I'll say about the enforcement chapter is I read another review of the agreement, and it was really interesting because it compared the TPP to prior free trade agreements like NAFTA and the Central American Free Trade Agreement and so on. And basically, the story is the protections and the enforcement of the protections used to be stronger, but with each new agreement, they get weaker. It talks in particular about a thing called an independent oversight body that's known as the Secretariat. In the NAFTA, it actually has enforcement capabilities, authorization. In the Central American Free Trade Agreement, it's there, but it can't do any enforcement of the environmental aspects. TPP doesn't even mention it. Doesn't have one. So the last thing I just want to mention, which is something that's not specific to TPP, but to trade agreements regularly, generally, and that's the effect they have on the regulatory process, like the formation of regulations. And there was a study done in Canada where they interviewed a whole bunch of people from the environment ministries of the provinces and of the federal government. Basically, you know, how did trade agreements and specifically investor-state dispute settlement affect their work? And the answer is it does. It basically infects their thinking about, you know, they've got one eye over their shoulder thinking, are we going to get sued if we propose this regulation? So not only do these agreements cause regulations to be unrolled after the fact, they actually inhibit the formation of sound regulation. Thank you.
That was great.
Thank you. That was really informative. We appreciate that. And now our final speaker before we're going to open up to questions and strategy and all that fun stuff is Ruth Shalom, and she is with Move On, and she's going to talk about next steps. So if you don't know Ruth, Ruth is involved in so many issues. When you talk about a leader who goes out there to do actions, Ruth is always there. She gets on television. She makes sure that her voice is heard. And you really should all be more like Ruth. So Ruth.
Exactly. That's awesome.
Before I talk about what I'm supposed to talk about, I'd like to digress. I was an asylum officer for many years, and I worked overseas processing refugees. So I'm very in tune with people who are oppressed and the issues involved with them. You just heard a number of speakers talking eloquently about why TPP is bad for labor and bad for drugs and bad for the environment. But TPP, there's a morality. It's bad for, we consider ourselves to have occupy the moral high ground in this country. And the TPP is very, very bad for our moral image. I don't know if you're aware that the Department of State puts out a publication. I believe it's every 5 years it's updated. It's country reports that talk about what's happening in the individual countries with labor and human rights and this and that and the other thing. And I don't know if you're aware that the report for Malaysia was horrendous because they have slave labor in Malaysia. Wow. And with because of the desire to have Malaysia be part of the TPP, the State Department was, they were put upon to actually upgrade Malaysia and say that improvements were being made on their human rights activities. It's not true, it's a lie. There are no improvements in Malaysia. And that was done simply so that we could put Malaysia in the TPP. One other thing I'll make a comment on. I don't think you know about this. Most people don't. Bolivia, it's not a TPP country. But about 8 months ago, Bolivia just legalized child labor. You can be 10 years old and work in Bolivia, and it's legal. Now, as I said, it's not a TPP country, but believe me, this is going to happen in TPP countries, and no one's going to say anything about it. When I read this about Bolivia, I went out of my mind because of, you know, my experiences with refugees and asylees, children who are abused. I called everybody. I called my congressman. I called my senators. I called this one. I called the president. Nobody was interested. Nobody would talk to me about it. Nobody seems to care. I haven't heard anything about it. Have you? Has anybody here heard about this?
Yeah.
But two people raised their hands out of this whole group. I haven't heard any, three, thank you. I haven't heard anybody and the government say that we're not going to be doing business with Bolivia until they change this law. Nothing, there's just no interest. And believe me, there's not going to be any interest in protecting human rights in the TPP countries. It's bad and it's going to get worse. Now, I just had to say it. I wasn't prepared for that, but it was just, I'm sitting here and cogitating and thinking, and I had to get it off my chest. It's really a disgrace. Thank you. I see everything from that point of view because, you know, that was the work that I did. I still do immigration work, but I don't do asylum work anymore or refugee work. But that's what I did for so many years. So it's really uppermost in my mind. I'm always thinking of that. It, you know, goes around in my brain. Anyway, I'm here today for a different reason. If all you do is attend this meeting, just attend here and listen to the speakers, but there's no follow-up, if you don't have any follow-up, you haven't made an impact. You haven't made an impact unless you do this. Take action. If you don't take action, all you've done was sit here, you drank coffee, you came to a nice, attractive room, and you sat and listened for 2 hours, but nothing's gonna happen. You must take action. We talked about it, Lisa gave you many ideas about taking action, so I don't wanna repeat what she said, but I'll just go over them briefly. I brought letters with me, by the way, for you to sign. I know Lisa said that a handwritten letter is the best thing, and it really is, but everybody doesn't have the time or the inclination to do that. I have prepared letters for Steve Israel, for Kathleen Rice, and also for Lee Zeldin. If you live in Lee Zeldin's district, which is all the way out on Long Island, it behooves you to thank him, because Lee Zeldin is quite unbelievably, he's against the TPP. He's a conservative Republican, and he's against the TPP. And I've gotten quite a few letters from out east where my children live, which I will bring personally to his office, thanking him for being against the TPP. So that you can, if you live out there and you want to sign a letter to Lee Zeldin, I have letters for that. I also have a letter for Steve Israel. You can sign a letter for him if you're in his district, and also one for Kathleen Rice. And Kathleen Rice's letter calls her out for just being duplicitous. She said that she was against the TPP, and now she turns around and she's for it. And it's calling her out and telling her that her supporters are very disappointed. It isn't what we expected from her. So I have those letters also. And I also have a sheet. I know Al Eric said that if we use his phone number, the number from Food and Water Watch, you can be automatically connected and the calls are counted. There's a chart made of who called whom. But I didn't realize that you were going to bring that with you. So I have like a little cheat sheet, and it has the phone numbers and the addresses of Kathleen Rice, Steve Israel, and Lee Zeldin. If you want to go there and pay them a visit in person, you can go. You don't need an appointment. Very often you can't get an appointment. Just drop in. They'll talk to you. They may not talk to you very long, but you can drop in, and it will make an impression if you do. So just go there and talk to them. Bring letters. Bring whatever it is that you want to do. Drop in is fine. Also, Steve Israel is retiring. He said he's not retiring to spend more time with his family, surprisingly. That's what they all say. I'm retiring to spend time with my family. His excuse is he's spending time to write a book. So maybe if you speak to him, you can wish him well, thank him for his past service, wish him well in his new literary career, and would he please not vote for the TPP? Okay, remind him of that. And it also has something that you can talk to Kathleen Rice about. Petitions, if you haven't signed the petition that we have there, please, before you leave, do sign the petition. And do see me, because I'll be sitting at the table with these letters that you can sign. Also, write letters to the editor. You'd be surprised, they get published. Mm-hmm. I write letters all the time to the Great Neck Record, because I live in Great Neck, the Anton newspapers. And the last one that I wrote was about 6 weeks ago. And they never published it, and I thought, well, that's it. They're not interested. All of a sudden, I open up the paper last week, and there was my letter. Every time I've written a letter, it may take a while. It's been published. So just sit down, write letters. People do read them. Mm-hmm. They read it. It's a good way of outreach, good way of reaching other people, because people do read the papers. So do that. Also, you can write letters to Newsday. Very hard to get published in Newsday. You can write a comment. Sometimes you'll find a column in Newsday. And for a day or two after, you can post a comment regarding that column. That's good, too. People do read the comments. But if you want to write letters to the editor, write to your local newspaper. You stand a very good chance of getting published. That's a big problem, is getting media coverage, because there are Long Island stations that don't cover Long Island news. They just don't. I belong to a group called the Long Island Media Task Force, and we're trying to get coverage for stories that are unreported, underreported, and lies, just plain old lies.
I think there needs to be some organized effort to bring this issue into the social media. It's very powerful.
We're going to have a brainstorming session now, and this is where it's leading, obviously. So I'm going to take my seat, and Lisa, you're going to take action, do something. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, Ruth. So we're going to, the rest of the time here, we want to really get deeper into what we should be doing. And I think the idea of a press conference is the exact kind of conversation we want to be having and strategy.
As a retired American, the problem with pharmaceuticals is much wider. The Affordable Care Act, when they made it, they wrote it, they did not put in that Medicare, which has huge buying power, cannot negotiate prices of pharmaceuticals. So the pharmaceutical, big pharma was in there lobbying all the time, and they lost the, they didn't get the power. And now, of course, there are many organizations that are interested in the Affordable Care Act and actually single payer, which is improved Medicare for all, that's HR 676, which Physicians for National Health Program have been fighting for 30 years to get. We have to get together on this whole business of the problems with health care as it's now given to this country. But of course, your comment about drugs is only part of it. It's a much larger issue.
This is a fight that we've been having constantly and for over 2 years. And one of the reasons why it was written into the Affordable Care Act was in order to get the act passed.
I know that. The politics, the lobbying was terrible.
And this magnifies our disagreement with TPP, because there's like nothing in there to help us, nothing to support lower drug prices for retirees and for people that are disabled that also get Medicare and Medicaid.
Well, what I'm trying to say is that people, not just retirees, should be fighting to get HR 676, which is single payer, and should be bothering everybody because, and Bernie, of course, Sanders wants it, yes. And they're trying to destroy the idea that you can get it.
Okay.
But that concerns birth to death.
Thank you very much. I see a question over here. You haven't asked one yet. And I'm going to remind everyone, clarifying questions.
Get right to the question. Since we're on healthcare social programs, this occurred to me. I've been working on this over a year. I can go into a little resume, Bell. I will spare us the time. But a question about social programs occurred to me just today when I was reading about Social Security. And I wondered, maybe you can answer this question for me, under a trade and services agreement, could financial service industry claim that social programs of countries constitute unfair competition and challenge things like Social Security as a way, using it as a wedge to privatize Social Security and Medicare? I've heard nobody talk about this, and like I said, I've been working on it for a year, and it's the first time it's occurred to me.
Can anyone answer that question? It's a great question. I can't.
I can't give you a clear-cut yes or no, this is how it would play out. I can give you my best guess, and that would be state-owned enterprises aren't addressed under the Trans-Pacific Partnership, right? So, I mean, this is probably the closest or the most closely related programs that we have that are the equivalent of a state-owned enterprise, if not the same. But then you also have investor-state dispute settlement systems. So, again, you have multinational corporations at the table. It really just depends on how it's negotiated, and it's up to them when it gets to the investor-state dispute settlements. So you're right. Yeah, I mean, it could be an issue. That's the reason I bring up investor-state dispute settlements, but state-owned enterprises, right? So you have countries like Vietnam that have state-owned enterprises that present unfair competition, but we opted not to address them in the Trans-Pacific Partnership for whatever reason. And so if they're protected in Trans-Pacific Partnership, maybe depending on the partners in TISA and the discussion they have, they become protected. If not, so again, I can't give you a clear cut yes or no, but those are just two things to think about.
Anyone else?
No.
A clarifying question and possible strategy that could be, since I'm a member of the Long Island Council Move On, nationally we represent about 7 or 8 million people. Why can't the ACLU start a class action lawsuit against the TPP?
It's a great idea. I think it's probably a little too early, right? Because they have to actually enact it. to then do it, I would think. I'm not so sure. Anyone else hear a comment on that?
Are you suggesting that the TPP is unconstitutional?
Well,
I mean, I hate to say this, just because something's bad doesn't mean it's unconstitutional.
Well, could I elaborate on that point a little bit? I'm a member of the Sierra Club. I'm not as active as I used to be some years ago. But I've had some conversations with Stephanie in the Atlantic chapter. And I personally, on my own, looked into challenging the constitutionality of Fast Track. There's a prominent constitutional lawyer in Washington, former Assistant U.S. Attorney General named Bruce Fine. Excuse me, I'm in a little trouble in my throat here. And he has been in touch with Representative Alan Grayson of Florida, Florida Democrat, who is very much opposed to the TPP. And the possibility of a challenge of the constitutionality of Fast Track does exist. That could be a fallback position if our efforts don't go the way we want. So just to answer that point.
And I think we're getting into the strategy discussion also, and I think that's a great place for us to be. If there are any clarifying questions, let's put them out there. If not, let's move to strategy. Oh, Claire? Oh, you want to just... There's a baby with a question.
We need to hear from that generation.
It's going to affect him more than us.
Awesome. Mike, I just had a question about the ISDS and was wondering what kind of precedence has been established under NAFTA and CAFTA, if there's any idea of what, you know, what where it might go in terms of, you know, who they've cited for or where the punitive actions have taken place.
Is Adam Weissman still in the room?
Yep.
Adam, is that a question you feel comfortable addressing? We're joined here by Adam Weissman, who is with Metro Trade Justice and is very knowledgeable about trade matters.
Sorry, can you
From what I understand, the ISDS is basically kind of the appeal board or whatever that where complaints would go between the two bodies or two where complaints would go. I was wondering, and it's been established for NAFTA and CAFTA, and for other you know, international trade agreements as well. I was just wondering what kind of precedence has been set or in the past. You know, can we look forward to see how that would be applied to TPP? You know, who makes up the ISDS? I mean, these are maybe I'm ignorant a bit about it, but just wondering, you know, if you had any more information about that.
Okay, so a couple of things about that we should be aware about ISDS. So the ISDS. Oh yeah. Okay. Sure. So ISDS tribunals are constituted. There are three arbitrator tribunals. The people who are arbitrating these tribunals are basically international trade lawyers who are brought into a particular tribunal with no conflict of interest clauses. These are private trade lawyers. In another week, they may be litigating on behalf of one of the companies in one of these suits or similar companies. Because there are no conflict of interest clauses, they can do that. There's also no appeals process. There are serious concerns in many of them around transparency. Some ISDS cases investment treaties between certain countries are actually, we don't know they exist. The cases aren't public at all. But so many of the normal procedures that we think are just a given in a domestic court proceeding don't exist for ISDS. The irony of ISDS is that the point of it is supposed to be that this is supposed to create a fair and objective venue for arbitrating cases. The argument is that the argument for ISDS is that corporations want the confidence that they can invest in a country and then not have their, say, not have ex- not have their resources expropriated, not have a country decide to nationalize their assets, and then that they have no resource in a corrupt court system. So the idea is that they have this objective venue, but the reality is the rules of these venues are something that we would never accept in our domestic courts. What has that meant in practice? Well, the good news for the U.S. is that while the U.S. has been challenged under in these investment tribunals in numerous cases under NAFTA, as of yet, the U.S. has won. Part of the reason for that may be that one of the venues where these tribunals are brought is the International Center for the Settlement of Investment Disputes, which is part of the World Bank, and the U.S. pretty much chooses the leadership of the World Bank, so we kind of have an in there. We have to consider that if you look at the countries that we're currently in free trade agreements with, that have these investment rules, most of them are not, there's Canada, but most of these are not countries like Japan, the third largest economy in the world, the home base of many global mega corporations that will have access to these investor rules under TPP. There are currently about 9,500 corporate subsidiaries that have operating in the US that can bring investor suits through these investment rules. TPP will bring in another 9,200. So it'll be about double to what already exists. And that means when you have a country like Japan, the world's largest importer of liquid natural gas, and a state passes a fracking ban, you can guess what will happen. Other countries haven't been as lucky under ISDS. There have been cases where good public interest policies have been challenged, and where what we would think should happen hasn't happened. Canada has been challenged and has lost pesticide cases. Canada has lost cases around toxic fuel additives. Mexico, there's a case against Mexico where Mexico tried to block a toxic waste dump and had to pay out $17 million for their audacity in not wanting to toxify their country. So ISDS has been highly effective for corporations to both, in practice, challenge environmental rules in existence. There's a case in Peru right now where Peru is being sued for $800 million by a U.S. investor for demanding remediation of a metal smelter site that's deemed one of the 10 most toxic sites in the world. And also, as was said, that not only does it challenge court rulings and laws, but it prevents countries from actually passing them out of fear of these massive potential payouts that they might have to pay to corporations.
Adam, can you just say your organization and your website? I know you guys have a lot of great information. You're spending a lot of time on this stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. So I work with Trade Justice New York Metro. We're a coalition of 68 organizations in the New York metropolitan area. Environmental groups, labor rights groups, food justice groups, peace groups, all who come together recognizing that we have a common agenda in fighting these trade deals. Within that coalition, and our website is tradejustice.net. Within that coalition, I work within a small organization called Global Justice for Animals and the Environment, which looks at how these trade agreements affect the environment, animal welfare, our food, as Eric addressed, and also the human rights of environmentalists. And if I could just plug, we have this Sunday. So some of you may have heard that TPP is actually, and this is, you're going to freak out when you hear this, if you haven't already heard this, the TPP is going to be signed next week in New Zealand. That does not mean TPP goes into effect. Under the bizarre rules of how these trade agreements are passed, first it gets signed, and then after that, Congress votes on it. Congress votes to implement it. If Congress doesn't implement it, nothing happens. But so this is a major milestone. Once it's signed, the president then has the discretion to send it to Congress at any point. Once it's sent to Congress, then the House has 60 days and the Senate has 90, but the president doesn't have to send it to Congress immediately after signing.
I know Mike Gendron, who's been a major leader in this campaign with CWA. I saw your hand up earlier. You know, let's start talking strategy. What are those ideas that you have in us moving forward, and what should we be doing?
The reason why I raised my hand earlier, it was suggested that we should, form an alliance and hold a press event. And in actuality, we've done numerous times. We've held rallies. We actually held a funeral procession march to Congressman Zeldin's office. The problem is that if the media doesn't want to publish it or cover it, then it never happened. So we do these things, but getting the media to actually go forward and to publicize it is a much harder issue for us. Mm-hmm. So I don't really have a clear-cut answer to that, but all I can say is that I think we do need to continue to have these actions and to try to sway certain members of Congress's votes on this to let them know that we're not going to go away. Right. And probably the best target for that would be Congresswoman Rice.
Right. So just so people know, in getting press, and we have someone from the press here who can kind of talk to that, the key is usually connecting it to something big that's happening, like a big vote, right? Like something that happens and then it's considered newsworthy, which makes it easier for them to come, but it's been very challenging. We're going to get to you in just a minute. We're going to get a few. Oh, yes, Ron.
So, I want to respond to a couple of the suggestions, all of which I think are extraordinary. Two things. First, I absolutely agree 100%. That we may eventually or will likely reach a point where we need to escalate to doing actions, to doing rallies, to doing press events, outside these offices, which Mike said we've done in the past and we're certainly prepared to do again. But in the meantime, in the weeks and months ahead, we need a steady drumbeat of calls. As I said, on a regular basis, a growing number of calls. We need to gather petitions. Food and Water Watch does have petitions. I urge you not only to sign the petitions, but to take them as well and get your friends and family and neighbors to sign them as well, so we have a critical mass of petitions. So at some point, again, in the months ahead, we can stage a mass delivery of petitions. But again, this is all part of an escalation process that, for better or for worse, we may reach. Second thing I'll note is that you all are the most reliable, trustworthy, and valuable message deliverers that we have. You can not only inform your friends and family and neighbors, but you can engage them as well. And that's not really something you can do even with like a paid TV ad. I mean, those are great, and we wish we had a multi-billion-dollar budget to take out those kinds of ads. But absent that, you are far better messengers than even than a TV ad. So I encourage you again, take the flyers, take the materials, use Facebook, use email, talk to people. That's really, I think, how we're going to win, is by each and one of you, multiplying this message and taking it forward. And again, with all the petitions and flyers and fact sheets. So.
Yeah, so I just wanted to comment on the question that was asked about investor-state dispute settlements and kind of tie it in with something Ruth brought up earlier, and that was the upgrade from Tier 3 to Tier 2 in terms of the State Department and their classification of Malaysia on human rights. In May of 2015, so less than a year ago, 139 makeshift graves were found. And it's estimated that 4 million workers, so 40% of their workforce, is slave labor, right? And we also had a question about investor-state dispute settlements. And Adam very eloquently rattled off several cases of how they were used and who used them. What you didn't hear was a single comment, sentence, iota, about a labor rights or a human rights violation. Because there's never been a fine or a tariff penalty imposed for labor violations in a single trade agreement the U.S. has ever been a part of. And again, I mentioned earlier the incentives that these corporations have or lack thereof, and the countries that we've partnered with or potentially are going to partner with through this trade agreement to enforce labor standards. Again, that's not going to change.
So there's another question.
Kathleen Rice promised us, Progressive Coalition, UAW, the Long Island Federation of Labor, personally, explicitly to that question, that she would oppose TPP. And she lied and betrayed us. It is absolutely outrageous that we don't have a candidate running against her. And if you cannot hold her accountable, what's the purpose of your petitions and your complaints if she knows it don't mean anything? So, I mean, My thing is the most important thing we could do is find a candidate who can provide at least a reason. Doesn't have to beat her. It has to really, you talk about getting press. An effective campaign would get some press, and it would put her, it would make her pay some price for absolutely betraying it. If you can't do that, you can't hold people accountable. The rest is begging, right? It really is begging. So, I mean, I just think if you can't do that, you really haven't done anything. Well, how can we, where can we find a candidate who will run against her and at least run a credible race, even if not to beat her? If they can beat her in the primary, that's even better. All right? But you need a candidate.
Anyone want to do it?
There he is.
I see a woman in the back.
I'm running for Congress in the 3rd District, so.
Oh, yeah. Exactly.
I think maybe if that could be a strategy, you could bring this up within the primary as it comes up, who supports it and who doesn't. I mean, I know the people that I'm running against, they're all multimillionaires, and I know they're not really friends to labor. So perhaps you can hold some of the Democrats' feet to the fire, because if we look at this and we think about it, NAFTA was passed under a Democratic president. This is supposed to be passed under a Democratic president. The Democrats are not standing up for labor, and the only people that we really have to blame for that are the people that are endorsing him and the people that are letting him get away with it. So I think at this point, it's time that we take back the Nassau County Democratic Party, make it for labor, have candidates that are actually truly for labor, and work from there. Because it's very nice. This is great that we're doing this, but this is reactive. And we're constantly putting out fires. You have to have candidates in there that's not going to even let this happen to begin with.
Why don't we move? Claire, you want to? Over there.
So this is question and strategy lumped together, and it has to do with the press attention you want and actually getting something accomplished. So
you are with the press, so everyone knows.
I'm with the press, but I'm a citizen, and
yes.
I'm very concerned
You're
about
an
this
activist.
Issue. I'm an activist, too. Anyway, so one thing in terms of publicity and what you could do, I'm thinking you get local governments to pass a referendum like they did with Kyoto. When the government didn't do Kyoto, local governments did their own version of Kyoto. You can get referendums that would get press, that would get local attention, and it would be preemptive, because once TPP is passed, you have to agree local governments are going to lose power. The second thing is goes back to the unconstitutionality of this thing. When I raised the question, can this be challenged in the Supreme Court, I was told that we don't have standing. We, the people, don't have standing. I have a different idea. I don't believe the president is empowered by the Constitution to give away powers that belong to the states or local governments. I think that is a constitutional issue, and the ones who would have standing are the Council of Mayors, the governors' associations. You could get all of those governmental bodies to sue, because they're the ones who are going to have to lose their power. They're the ones whose residents are going to have to be paying tax money to fight these suits and give up their local codes and protections.
So one strategy, what you're bringing up here is a challenging strategy, but many of us know our local elected officials, right? And have these conversations. See if they're willing to do it, because I'll tell you, if you can give me a mayor on Long Island, give me a town supervisor, some town legislators, some county legislators who are willing to do a press event, we will get press on this thing. And who are willing to stand up to say this is wrong and we're gonna sue. We will be able to get that. So if everyone can have individual conversations with the people they know, you know, let us know and let's try to organize them.
Yeah, that's a phenomenal suggestion. As it happens, just a couple of nights ago, the city of Syracuse, you know, here in New York, the city council passed a resolution against the TPP. And that's definitely something that the Sierra Club, the Alliance for Retired Americans, Food and Water Watch, is definitely encouraging communities, municipalities, you know, as collective bodies. The Albany County passed a resolution against the TPP. As I mentioned, you know, New York City Council last year passed a resolution against Fast Track. That's something we would definitely encourage. You know, again, whether it's, you know, individual elected officials or collective bodies, you know, speaking out against this resolution, against this agreement, that could be very, very influential.
Yep. Great idea.
What should people be saying in these letters that I haven't heard here tonight? And one of the biggest things they should be saying is, put it in historical perspective. Back in the 80s, in the early 80s, there was a movement within the United Nations to create the new world economic order. It was going to be including in bringing up the rules of this were representatives of, most importantly, labor, but also the environment and human rights groups. Who killed it? The same major corporations who today are backing this. What was their argument? How were they convincing people that this was the right thing to do at that time? That it would infringe on national sovereignty. That's what they were saying back then. These same corporations today are the only ones who sat at the table drawing this up. Wow. And now they are for it. The hell with national sovereignty. The question that should be asked of our representatives in our letters is, who do you work for?
Exactly. Amen, brother.
It's a great campaign slogan. Awesome.
Who do you work
Who else? Because we have to, just like a couple of more things. We have a young guy in the back.
This kind of piggybacking on some of the things that were just said, and it's more about framing and narrative, but if, especially this is geared towards Republicans, how can they justify this kind of top-down, So if a result of the TPP is going to be a restriction and loss of sovereignty of local governments, and they're supposed to be a party of decentralized governance and getting rid of big government, how can they rightfully stand by and let a process go through that is going to take away the strength and autonomy of small government?
Well, one thing to be clear about, the Tea Party opposes the TPP.
Right. We lobbied with
Donald
that.
Trump
cool
opposes the TPP. There are some very right-wing members of Congress for various motivations, some because they just hate anything that Obama stands for. But you're absolutely right. I mean, there are Republicans that are concerned about jobs, domestic jobs, that are concerned about threats to sovereignty. In fact, there's a congressman from the Southern Tier. The first member of the U.S. delegation to come out publicly against the TPP was Tom Reed, who's a right-wing Republican from the Southern Tier of New York.
Exactly. We, you know, in the coalition, and Mike Gendron put this together, we lobbied with the Tea Party, right? And we're going to do it again, if we can. So any last burning things? Yes, sorry.
Yeah. I wanted to make a comment just to go over things. Nobody knows about TPP. That man was absolutely correct. Even my relatives that are very smart with masters and doctorates, they don't know about TPP. What we need is a sheet of all the things that we talked about tonight in a form that you can read right away, like the loss of jobs. We can mention how Buick is going to have their cars made in Spain and Korea, and there's another country next year. We could have about child labor. I think it's Vietnam or Thailand, one or the other, that is allowed to have child labor for 8 years. And they're also the ones that have poor people from Malaysia that come in and they take away their passports and they put them out in boats. And if they cause trouble, they don't come back from the boat ride. So we have to talk about the pharmaceutical, like you made beautiful comments on that, and then you followed it up by specific right. influence. We have to do that, the layer, and then you follow up by what it, the wording in it that you need to follow. What else did they said? Oh, the labeling, you talked about labeling, about bringing in the shrimp and the fish and stuff. We need to see it in a sheet.
Yep. So there are fact sheets, right? And so do you guys have fact sheets on your website? I know there's a lot of different fact sheets.
We'll say, and
but
what
we don't have the
New York Coffee Party has actually assembled a fact sheet that I think, you know, summarizes a lot of these points. I mean, Food and Water Watch, you know, as I mentioned, has an abundance of fact sheets that address some of our particular concerns.
Well, we need
also
all
mentioned
the
one other thing. Public Citizen is another very, very good resource. If folks aren't familiar with them, that's the organization that Ralph Nader instituted in the early 70s. And if you go to publiccitizen.org, I think they may have the best.
So I want to just give you one hint of how to have these conversations with your friend and family. You know what they care about. You know what their problems are. You know if they're buying prescription drugs, and they have to pay $50 to $70 for their prescription instead of being generic, right? So what I'm saying is, when you talk and you're trying to convince people and educate them on it, it's so hard. This thing is just huge, right? It's so hard. Think about the self-interest of your family and friends, what they care about within all of these things, and then you could actually point out some individual facts on it. So, but that is a great idea to do that.
We need to have the information. We need to have the facts.
Yep. It's all there. There's so many fact sheets on this. I was actually looking up for stuff for today for myself. I mean, there's so much online. We can help you get them and the stuff you could focus on. So many organizations have spent a lot of time on doing this. So that stuff is out there. Don't think the groups on Long Island are not focusing on this. We are. There's a coalition. Now that you came today, we're going to bother you whenever there's an event, whenever there's an action. We're going to make sure that you're helping with it. You get to come to it. You get to bring your friends and family. And really, the key is for us just to continue to do this. I want to thank everyone on the panel. I think you guys did a great job. Everyone in the audience. Claire was great with the microphone. It's a hard job. Thank you, everyone, for coming, and have a good night.